Kruse. Welcome to my channel. If you're new, please subscribe and hit that notification bell. Also, follow me on social media at Miss Tori Kruse. I really appreciate it. All right, so today we have Shandi Finnessey Higgins. And Shandi is, of course, Miss USA 2004, competed in Miss America. You're an amazing mentor, coach, and dear friend. So welcome to the show, and thank you so much for your willingness to talk today. And I'm just so excited to hear all of the advice that you have for the young women watching.
Yeah, I'm excited to be a part of your show. I'm so proud of you for doing this and inspiring people. So thank you for having me be a guest.
Yes, of course. So first, I want to just start off, of course, we have to touch on pageantry right away because that's where our background is. But Shandi was actually a former Miss Missouri USA. So we're pageant sisters from the same state, which is amazing. But then you went on to win Miss USA, which is obviously so incredible. Tell me a little bit about your journey and share with everyone kind of like the ups and downs and what you went through, how many times you competed before you won, and all of the inside scoop.
Well, it was 15 years ago now, which is insane to think that it just flew by. But it was just such a highlight of my life. So up until the year that I won, I felt like in pageantry, I kept trying to, which a lot of girls do, become somebody in interview, become somebody at the pageant where I, you know, am I good enough? Am I the one that you think should win? And it would cause a lot of nerves. When I would step into interview, I would get super nervous because I would always think like, will I have the right answer for the judge? Will I say what they want to hear? And because I wasn't being authentic to myself, it caused a lot of anxieties. Like if you put your hand on my stomach during pageant weekend, you could actually feel it shaking because I was so nervous. And every single pageant up until the year that I went all the way, I would tell myself pageant weekend, this is my last pageant I'm ever doing. I'm done after this pageant because I was so nervous. And then of course, you know, a year would go by and you'd be approaching the next pageant season. I'm like, okay, I'll try it one more time. And so the year that I went all the way was the year that through a chain of events, I had a group of people who, long story short, they were able to sort of get into my head and tell me to be myself, which you always hear that, but it's really hard to do. And I started to realize that who I am in everyday life, if I'm talking to the checkout lady at the grocery store and I crack a little joke, that I like who I am. People like who I am. And so I started to just sit in that space of being myself. And when I went into the interview room at both Missouri USA and Miss USA and Miss Universe, I told myself that above everything else, I wanted the judges to really get to know me. And that if my best friend was sitting in the interview room, she would go, oh my God, that's so Shandi, instead of like, who are you trying to be? And so I said things and behaved in a way that wasn't like Pageant Patty or Rebecca Robot on how I had been up until that point. And it worked really well for me. And so I think that was like the big determining shift that I went through. And that's now what I kind of coach girls through, is just finding their authentic self and showcasing that and not trying to fit into that mold of what they think they should be. But in terms of the pageants, I did Miss America in 2002 and was trying to fit that mold, so I didn't even place. And then Miss USA in 2004.
That's amazing. And then you placed first runner up at Miss Universe. Yeah. And what was that experience like? There's, of course, how many countries competed that year?
My year, I think there were 82 or 83 countries, and it was amazing because you have these girls that are the epitome of beauty from their own countries. So you had like tan skin and super curvy bodies with like beautiful like flowing hair. You had really, really dark skin and like long skinny neck, like from somewhere in like North Africa. Mm-hmm. You had like all these different people that are the epitome of beauty in their culture, and it was really amazing. But more so, you have all these countries that don't speak the same language, and we're together for 3 weeks in Quito, Ecuador. And so we were able to still communicate. You sort of almost resort to charades to talk to each other, which was really kind of cool. But then even more so than that, you had countries like Lebanon and Israel who were standing, because you have to stand in alphabetical order based on your country. So they're standing relatively close to each other. and their countries are such at odds, and yet these two girls were able to get together and be friends. And it just showed you that, you know, we can kind of set aside what's going on in our countries and what we are conditioned to maybe believe or stand for or against, and just come together in those 3 weeks. It was really beautiful to see all of us be friends for those 3 weeks.
That's amazing. And that's actually reminds me of something I talk about in my keynotes, is that it's really important for everybody to become friends with people who are different from you. And that's just how you learn and grow so much, just as an individual. So I think that's really an amazing experience that you had personally to learn from other people that really didn't even speak your own language.
Yeah. I mean, it was amazing. And like one of the girls from the Middle East, she was actually told that because she wore a bikini on stage, that she wasn't allowed back into her country, and wow, she would be murdered if she was. And so the Miss Universe organization had to try to find like safe refuge for her. And it's just crazy, you know, what we went through during those 3 weeks, but it was a really neat experience.
Absolutely. So what were some of the challenges that you faced personally as either Miss Missouri or Miss USA, and how'd you overcome those challenges?
I would say one of the bigger challenges that I faced, I didn't really even see it until I got to Miss Universe. In 2004, the United States had just invaded Iraq, and there was a lot of anger against the United States, against our president. We had President Bush at the time. Mm-hmm. And there was a lot of hostility. When we were in Ecuador, we would do these parades, and there would be hundreds of thousands of people that would come out, and the streets were lined, but you'd go past an alley and you would see half a mile back just people. Their little heads were like pins way off in the distance, and you would think like, oh my gosh, you came out and I can't see you, you can't see us, but it's just to be there. But there were a lot of people holding up signs that said US out of Iraq. Wow. And that would be screaming at me as though I had anything to do with it. And they had to have extra security on me at all times. I always had a security guard with me. And then even throughout my year, I did a lot of interviews on Fox News, CNN. Like, I just did a lot of the news outlets talking about my position on the war and my thoughts on the president. And it was just interesting because on one hand, I'm thinking, okay, I'm not working in the White House. I'm a beauty queen. But then on the other hand, it was really cool that I was allowed to voice my opinion and have that opportunity. So then on the flip side, I then did a lot with the USO and with Wayne Newton, just in support of our troops. And I was able to travel to Korea, to Cuba, and to Germany, wow, in support of our troops. Yeah.
That's amazing.
So I would say that was probably the biggest kind of thing that I dealt with during my year.
Right. So after your pageant journey, did you ever have that period where you were just like, okay, I was just Miss USA and I didn't win Miss Universe, and now I have to discover this whole other dream? And mm-hmm. How did you overcome that adversity mentally?
Yeah, actually. So I was one of, if not the oldest person to win Miss USA.
I was up there too. When I
competed. Yeah. Well, I was either 26 when I won and 27 when I gave up my title, or 25 when I won, 26 when I gave up my title. I don't remember, but I was one of the older ones. And like halfway through the year, it felt weird to me. I loved doing the appearances. I loved everything that the job entailed. But the second I had to put on like a crown and a sash and like walk into a room, I felt really kind of silly and like I was playing dress up. So I was looking forward to the next chapter for a while. Mm-hmm. And about halfway through my year, I knew that I had my eye on moving to Hollywood and working in the entertainment industry. And so toward the end of my year, the Miss Universe organization, they were able to help set me up with my agent at the time, which was Abrams Artist. And I moved out to Los Angeles, and I was excited about it. I was excited to hang up my pageant shoes and take on this new role. And I was really fortunate that I was only out here for just almost 3 months when I landed my first job working on the Game Show Network. And then it just was one thing after the next, and I was able to stay out and just keep working. And I was on Dancing with the Stars and more of the Game Show Network. And I kind of stayed in that game world for a number of years. So I think humans just don't like change. Mm-hmm. I'm someone who like when I graduated college and I'm driving off campus, I was like bawling and everyone else was like partying. I think most people though don't like change, but I try to embrace it and to see it as opportunity, because you can't hold on to certain things. Like you can't hold on to the title as much as you may want to. You can't hold on to high school when you graduate. You've got to be able to let things go. And so rather than living from a place of regret and sadness, to kind of look at the opportunity of what's to come, whether you know what's around the corner or not, but to just have that optimistic outlook.
Yes, that's incredible advice. And with everything that you've been doing between, you know, the entertainment world and then pageants, and then of course now you are an entrepreneur, it takes a lot of confidence, right, to do all these things. How do you keep that confidence level up at every single point in your life?
I think it's really important, whatever you decide to do, to give it 100%. Mm-hmm. And then give yourself a time frame and then reevaluate and see, is this working out in my favor or is it not? I think too often people will give 70%, 75%. They don't give 100%. For whatever reason, they have their own reasonings behind it. Sometimes it's just self-handicapping. They do it that they don't put in 100% effort that way. If it doesn't work out, they're like, oh, well, I didn't really try that all that hard. But sometimes it's because they have other priorities and they want to hang out with friends or their boyfriend or whatever, you know, their other priorities are. But I'm a firm believer of give it 100%. And if it doesn't turn out the way you wanted, then change direction. So with pageants, I literally gave like Miss Missouri USA, Miss USA, 100% of my focus and dedication. I truly left no stone unturned. And then when I moved out to Los Angeles, it was the same thing. Like if I had a meeting with an executive at Fox the night before or days before, I would be studying that person, who they are, other shows that they've worked on, everything you could possibly imagine. And then I would get, like, the meeting was at 10, I would get there at 9 so that I made sure that I had parked, I was all ready, I would go grab a coffee, I would read through my notes again. Like, I was just so prepared. And there was actually a Miss USA after me who was represented by my same agent at one moment. And I found out that she was just like missing meetings and this and that. And her manager had said, well, I mean, she's a young girl, that's what you got to expect. And I remember being like, no, like you've got to give it 100%. Like it just shows your commitment. And the same with starting a business, you know, go in, like jump in with both feet, totally submerge yourself. And then I believe that if you are on the right track, things just happen naturally and it isn't a constant uphill battle. So we gave it 100% and we sat back and watched, and things just started working out easily for us. And so it just seemed like a natural fit. But then I've also, you know, done things in my life, relationships and whatnot, that I gave it 100% and it wasn't right. And so I did have to change gears. So I think that's the important thing is to really commit yourself, whatever it is. Otherwise, why waste your time giving less than 100%?
And so I always say, go with your gut, go with your intuition, because it's way stronger than we know. What do you recommend as far as knowing when, okay, this chapter may be over, let's try something new?
It's really hard because a lot of times our brain is telling us something and we're like, well, is that like my gut or is that my brain? It's really hard to tell the difference between the two, because sometimes we want something so badly that we don't let ourselves give it up. Mm-hmm. So you almost have to take it from a very objective standpoint and kind of like even have someone outside of you help you with it, whether it's a parent or a best friend, who you can just kind of run through it. Like, did I do everything I could have possibly have done? Is there anything I can do differently to move forward, to have a mentor in your life that can really help to guide you? And if you've truly exhausted everything, then maybe, you know, look to see what your next step is. Like if it is changing directions, if it's career wise, because if it's pageantry, everything's like a little different. So you have to kind of guess like or figure out what category you're in. But if it's career-wise, I think align yourself with mentors who are similar to what you want to do, and then have real heart-to-hearts with them. And if you just are so in left field and out of the ballpark, you know, hopefully they'll help guide you and be like, this doesn't seem to be your strength. Your strength seems to be this. Like, how about we try something else? Mm-hmm. So I think just aligning yourself with people like that.
So switching gears now from, you know, more or less pageantry to career to your entrepreneurial world now, and you're a mama, but entrepreneurial world too. Tell us a little bit about your company, Pageantology, and what you and Susie do.
Yeah, so we started our business, Susie and I, called Pageantology in 2013. It came together because I had been training pageant girls for a number of years. I had people reach out to me after Miss USA just asking me to help train them for their pageant. Mm-hmm. So I was doing it on my own, and Susie, being a former Miss USA as well, was judging pageants. And she had just gotten back from judging Miss Massachusetts, and we were having lunch. And we were kind of talking about our strategy going into the pageant, and they were very similar, even though we are two, like, apples and oranges. We went through a lot of the same preparations when competing for Miss USA. And then we started talking about girls who compete in pageants and how sometimes if they do just a little bit of something, a little more of something or a little less of something, that it can actually work in their favor. Mm-hmm. And in that discussion, we just decided, like, why don't we partner up and start teaching something? So what we do now is we coach girls in all different pageant systems. We tend to focus mostly on Miss USA, Miss Teen USA, and Miss America, but we do all kinds of pageant systems, even the Mrs. pageant systems. And we just help girls to kind of, our main focus is that we help girls look beyond the pageant and what do they want to do with life? What is their ultimate career goal? And then how do they set themselves apart from all the other girls that are on that path? And that's what we term a brand. And then it's how do you focus on your brand and are able to effectively communicate it in your judge's interview, no matter what's being asked of you. Nowadays, more than ever, pageants are so much more than just a beautiful face who stands and waves. It's a girl who has a message and wants to leave an impact. And so it's helping her to get to that place and to be authentically who she is in that space.
Right, exactly. And I can vouch for all that because you guys were amazing and helped me get to where I am today. So I still-
You were amazing. We loved working with you so much.
We had so much fun. After our FaceTimes were over, our Skype sessions, I was so sad. I was like, oh, I still need to talk to them. I need my Shandi Susie fix.
You guys, like, we'll compete in another pageant so we can train you again.
I know. But so through Pageantology, you've, you know, dealt with so many different girls and you've taught them many different interview skills, and everybody's skills are completely different. And I know you tailor them directly towards each client 100%. What would you say to young girls who are maybe even going for a job interview? How can they prepare for that and just feel confident when they walk into the room?
I think to recreate that situation as many times as they can, over and over and over, so it doesn't feel so foreign when they step in that room. Mm-hmm. A lot of times it's just the nerves, whether you're in a pageant or a job interview. You walk into that room and it's so, all of your adrenaline's going, and you're so nervous that you step out of the interview room after it's over and you're like, I'm not even sure what they asked me. And it's just kind of all a whirlwind. So it's recreating that so it feels like you've already been in there. So we have people, and I even did it with my older brother, who's 8 years older than me. He was going in for a job interview years ago, and I was like, all right, let's do your mock interviews. And it was just having someone, anyone, a mom, a parent, a sibling, a friend, or even just yourself, like randomly in the shower, and you sound like a weirdo, but you're talking to yourself. But to ask yourself, have questions being asked, and then answer them, while not trying to please the person of this is what I think they want to hear, but really being true to yourself and being very descriptive with whatever your answer is so that you don't sound generic. So what I mean by that is if in a job interview, like, why do you want this job? And you say, oh, I just love this company, I love the people that work here, and you give a generic answer that the person who comes in the interview room after you can give the exact same answer, it's not going to make you memorable. But if you can be very specific and say, oh, I love that your company 2 years ago did blah, 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 I resonate with that because I grew up doing this. And I understand that you know, your vice president is this person. They went to this school. I went to that school too. And you can get very specific on something. That's what's memorable. So whether you're in your pageant interview or an actual job interview, you just want to leave them knowing more about you.
Absolutely. And a big thing in interviews too is the dreaded question of, like, what is your worst, not even like your best quality, but what's your worst quality you could bring? Like, it's the most negative twist that you could ever bring to an interview. but I know some employers and maybe even some judges will ask the girls that. And how do you spin that around so it's a positive?
Well, so many times girls will say, well, I'm a perfectionist and I just loved it. And they think that that's like what they want to hear. And I do think, again, you just have to be authentic to yourself, because they're not actually wanting to know what's your worst habit. They're right. wanting to know, like, how good are you at communicating? And are you interesting to talk to? And when the interview is over, do I wish that I had more time to speak with you? I judged Miss California USA years ago, and somebody asked that question to a girl, and this poor girl answered it a little too authentically, because you want to answer it authentically, but you also right. don't want to like scare the judges. And this is horrible, but she said, oh, my worst trait, I sit on the ground and I pull my foot up and I suck on my big toe and then I bite my toenail off and I spit it across the room. And we were all like, what? Like, don't actually tell us your worst trait. You know, it's like, so you have to like pick and choose your audience here.
I mean, a little happy medium.
Right? Like, you know, hands down, my worst trait, and I think a lot of women, especially moms, this is their worst trait, is being a mad control freak. Like, I am a mad control freak. And I know that that's my weakness, and I try really hard to work on it, and it will forever be a New Year's resolution. And, you know, there's not like necessarily a positive spin that I can put on it. Other than I make sure that I'm like dotting all my I's and crossing all my T's and that sort of thing. But it drives anyone crazy that's around me. But when I'm interviewing, and if a judge asks me a question and I'm telling them that, it's that they just want to see my personality and see me talk, and they're not really judging what I'm saying. And I feel like that's how most interviews are, is they are judging a little bit on what you're saying, but they're looking at like, are you likable? Are you a team player? Will you be easy to work with? Will we enjoy having you work under us? That's what they're looking for.
Yes. Last but not least, let's touch on being a mama. Like, how do you juggle being a career woman, but then also being this amazing mom?
Yeah. I was just telling my girlfriends the other day, for me personally, I know some people really want children young and it's like the best decision they ever made. I am so grateful I waited as long as I did. I'm also grateful that we didn't have any fertility problems, because sometimes right. when you wait, then you have a hard time getting pregnant. But I'm so grateful that I waited. I had my first baby when I was 38, I believe. And then my second one right before I turned 40. And I'm so grateful I waited, because it allowed me to live my life. Like, I have traveled, I have just done everything that I possibly want to do. Because I personally believe, like, when you have kids, your life stops. And that sounds like sad, and it's not meant to be sad. But if you're the type of mom that I am, like, I don't personally, like, I don't want nannies. I don't want someone else raising my kid. And a lot of my friends, like, that's what they want, and that's fine if it works for them. But I never grew up with nannies, and so I just want to be the main caregiver in their life. And when I'm working and training girls, I'll have sitters. But it's when I'm working, and we set aside hours for that. It's not every day. And so I'm glad that I waited, because not only did it allow me to like set my life aside and be okay with that, and to fully plug into my kids, because it does go by so quickly. But also I feel like we have like the financial means now to be able to like really plug into our kids. I feel like I'm emotionally more like, I understand the responsibilities of it. Cause it is exhausting and tiring, but you know, it's not forever. So, I think being a mom is the most incredible, amazing thing. After my first son was born, I remember being like, I was Miss USA and this is better. Like, and I remember just being like, you know, I chose Miss USA. I worked hard for it. And then also a lot of luck play came into it. And then I won. Like, babies, anyone can have babies. And that is like, that's better than the crown. It's like the most amazing thing ever. And I always joke saying, if I had started younger, I'd probably have like 12 kids or something.
Oh, crazy. Definitely. I can totally see you having 12 kids.
Totally. I would be like the little old lady who lives in a shoe. And so it's so amazing to be able to plug into them and watch them grow. And I personally think I have these two sweetest little boys. the way that they love on me is just ridiculous. And they're the kindest, most gentle little beings. And I'm just, that's what I live for now, hands down. I had to choose between being a mom and giving up my job, I'd give up my job in a heartbeat.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you're such a great mom. I've seen your little boys. They're so cute. They're adorable. And they are. They're really good. But it's also because of you and your husband and how you have raised them and continue to just like pour love into them. So I just think that's so important. And you found a healthy balance, it seems like, between your career and also being a mom. So also a lot of moms, I'm not a mama yet, but someday, hopefully. But what is it like to actually like not lose yourself or your relationship with your husband? I see a lot of moms just like, oh my gosh, they pour everything into their kids and then their relationships kind of disappear or go down in the dumps. How do you like keep up with yourself and fulfill yourself, but then also your relationship?
Yeah. I remember hearing a long time ago that a lot of moms like put their kids first and the husband, how that makes them feel. We didn't ever have a single sitter for 1 hour with our firstborn until he was over a year. He was about 15 months old.
Wow.
Yeah. And I had a pageant girl watch him for like 2 hours for us to go out, and I was a nervous wreck. But I wanted, like up until one, I feel like the kid still needs their mom like all the time. But once he was old enough, we then have started weekly date nights, no matter what. Even if it's like, we're just going to Chipotle
right.
and just sitting and talking, or if we're going to some like 5-star dining. Mm-hmm. But it's a chance for us to get away from the kids and to just plug into each other. And the kids used to kind of be a little sad over it. Like, mommy, you're leaving. Like, I want to go to the restaurant. And it's like, well, mommy and daddy have to do this for us. And so I just think it's, and I have so many friends that don't do that. They don't take date nights. And I just think it's important to just try to put your spouse above the kids and try to keep it there. I think it's just so valuable, because if you guys don't have that really strong unity, everything else is going to crumble.
Yeah. Well, that's a amazing relationship 101, and I'll be taking notes over here for someday when we hit that point. But no, that's super helpful, because I know there's probably some moms that are listening and they're like, wow, she is superwoman, and you pretty much are, but how do you do it? So I just really appreciate all your advice on that too. So wrapping up here, do you have any other just like lasting advice for any women that are listening, whether they're in pageants, career, college, maybe they're new moms?
Yeah, just anything. I think no matter what, no matter where you are in life, if it's pageantry, if it's a new mom, if it's in a career, I think sometimes we just get so busy with life that we're literally almost in survival mode. Like, we're just living each day. And I think it's really important occasionally to look forward. We often do it around New Year's when we make New Year's resolutions of how the year should go. I think we should do it way often than just New Year's. In the Persian culture, actually, they study New Year's around our springtime. And that makes so much more sense, because that's when everything is new growth and new birth. And instead, our New Year's is when everything is like freezing and cold and tends to be more sedentary, and things hibernate. And it's like, that's really when you shouldn't be doing all this new stuff. You should do it in spring. But I think maybe like 4 times a year, like as the seasons change, to look to see where you are, to see where you want to go, and then to start making changes. So if you're a pageant girl and you're like, okay, I know that I gained some weight, like I've got to do something in this next quarter. So change your diet, change your workout routine, whatever, like do things. If you're a new mom and you realize like, oh my gosh, like I've got so many bags under my eyes, my bags have bags, I'm not getting the sleep that I need, then reevaluate that and be like, okay, I need to take 1 hour a week and just get a sitter in to just hang out and play with my kid. And I am going to use that time to like take a bath and put a mask on to just pamper yourself. But I think too often we just get in survival mode, and then we go to bed and start over the next day and start over the next day. And that'll eventually just grind you into the ground. Even in relationships, like if a relationship is, I was talking with a friend the other day that they're unfortunately heading toward a divorce, and you could see that the wheels were coming off of the train, and they didn't do anything about it then until it's already gone. There's no salvaging it. And you know, you need to stop sometimes and evaluate and go, okay, something needs to be fixed, and then address whatever that is, and to not just keep letting it go and let it go, because it will turn into a snowball effect.
That's so good. And so if any pageant girls specifically want to get a hold of you, or you and Susie both, to work with both of you, I know you're doing individual lessons now, I saw. So congratulations on that new role with Pageantology. But if they want to contact you, how do they do that? And also work with you with Pageantology.
If they just want to train with me, it's the email shandi@pageantology.com, S-H-A-N-D-I @pageantology.com. If they want to work with the both of us, it's info@pageantology.com. And that gets them all the information that they possibly need.
And where can they find you on social media?
On social media, I'm just Shandi Finnessey.
And then also you have a YouTube channel as well, right?
It's Pageantology 101.
They are amazing coaches, and I'm just so honored to talk to you today. And I just miss seeing your face all the time. Can we do this more often?
Thank you for having me be on.
Yes, of course. Thanks so much. Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed that episode just as much as I did. Please put your comments below, click subscribe, and hit that notification bell. Also, follow me on social media @Miss Tori Kruse. Until next time, be unstoppable.